Jeff Silgett, USA Today. Adam, when it comes to the one and done rule, what are the state of those discussions right now? What ideas have emerged as possible solutions, and what kind of timeline do you envision of changing that rule?
So, Jeff, in terms of one and done, I think that there's a lot going on. One, that there is a commission that Mark Emmert and the NCAA appointed, led by former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice. And so that commission that includes college presidents, college athletic directors, you know, some former NBA players, is taking an overall look at the issue. And we realize that the whole nature of the one and done is that we don't operate in isolation, and that where we choose to set with our players association, the minimum age has a direct impact on college basketball as well. So in part, we've been having discussions with Condoleezza Rice's commission, and so as I understand it, they're looking to issue some recommendations in the spring, so we'll be interested to see where they come out on that. In terms of the NBA, we're conflicted, to be honest. We're outside of our cycle of collective bargaining right now, which is when we generally address an issue like that, but Michelle Roberts and I have also agreed that there's no reason we shouldn't at least be discussing it right now. So we've had some meetings with the Players Association where we've shared data on success rates of young players coming into the league. We've talked a lot about youth development in terms of whether we should be getting involved in some of these young players even earlier than when they come into college. And from a league standpoint, on one hand, we think we have a better draft when we've had an opportunity to see these young players play at an elite level before they come into the NBA. On the other hand, I think the question for the league is, in terms of their ultimate success, are we better off intersecting with them a little bit younger? Are we better off bringing them into the league when they're 18, using our G League as it was designed to be as a development league, and getting them minutes on the court there? And there's also a recognition that for some of these elite players, there's no question that they can perform in the NBA at 18 years old. And just the last thing I'll throw in there, just as another factor, and I hear this from players in our league all the time, is that don't forget the vets. And it's not just in terms of minutes on the floor, but they play an important role in mentoring young players as well, even for some of the veterans who may never have much playing time in terms of games. They're important to be in the locker room, they're important during practice time. So that's something we have to look at too, whether by, if we shifted our minimum age from 19 to 18, we'd bring the whole league younger, because the jobs have to come from somewhere. So we're not by any means rushing through this. I think this is a case where, actually outside of the cycle of collective bargaining, we can spend more time on it with the Players Association, talking to individual players, talking to their executive board, and really trying to understand the pros and cons of potentially moving the age limit.
Third row on the right, Steve.
Steve Ashburner, NBA.com. Adam, today a small number of players and referees met to talk about their working relationship and you know, take ideas back to their groups. I'm wondering what your thoughts are on the issues that led them to this point, and how active or passive a role should the league take in sort of bridging any gaps?
Well, the latter part of your question first, I think the league, of course, should be playing a very active role in bridging that gap between players and officials. And we put in place several new initiatives, including a new management team overseeing our officiating program. Michelle Johnson, relatively new hire, who oversees our referee training. She was the former superintendent of the Air Force Academy. Incredibly credentialed woman who happened to be an All-American basketball player herself at the Air Force Academy and a distinguished career. And she's been brought in, in essence, as a management expert to help us work on improving our overall officiating program. We just took Monty McCutcheon off the floor, who was our number one rated official. And I realize some people could view that as a step back, but the notion was, over time, we'd be getting more out of Monty to the extent that he was responsible for the direct training of our officials and not just as an official on the floor. So we're playing a very active role. And on top of that, we started a program about a month ago where mid-season, we used to only do this preseason, we're sending groups of officials out to meet directly with our teams so they can have open forums to talk about issues like respect and empathy and create a better understanding with the players in terms of what the officials' roles are, and make officials maybe better understand how players may misperceive things they're doing. In terms of the meeting that took place this morning, I don't know a lot about it, I mean, in terms of what happened today, because I haven't talked to any of the participants, but I read the press release they put out. I was pleased to see, again, they focused on those themes of respect and empathy. I'd also say I think it's fantastic. It's a great statement about this league that these important stakeholders, in this case, our players and the officials, think it's important enough and that they have an obligation to the game where they should be sitting down and talking to each other. Because at the end of the day, I mean, as I said before, I've never thought this was just about ratcheting up fines. You know, I think that there's a larger issue in play here, and almost one a little bit societal, and we're sort of, we owe it to young fans who are watching, we owe it to people who get enormous satisfaction out of sports to see that we truly can get all along and be respectful and empathetic, and the fact that these two groups want to sit down with each other and say, how can we both do a better job, how can we create a better understanding, I think is fantastic.
Any thoughts on how everybody got to this point, where there was the friction?
Number one, I'd say in terms of the data we keep in the league office, this point to me doesn't seem that different than points we've been at prior years. If you recall, you've been covering the league a long time. I think it was roughly 8 years ago or so we adopted these respect for the game rules, precisely because everyone said at that point, you know, things were a little bit out of control and there was a lot of frustration. And we adopted those rules. I think after we did it, some people felt it was a little bit of an overreaction, that we were turning the players almost into robots, and that of course they need to show a certain amount of emotion on the floor, and a certain amount of emotion was appropriate and wasn't disrespectful of referees. And we reset a little bit there. We may have slid a little bit back to some old practices. But so, you know, at least in terms of the number of technicals called, number of fouls called, the things we look at the league office, there's nothing all that aberrational going on right now. But I accept that to the extent there's a perception right now that there's an issue, we want to use that as an opportunity. And the fact that we have referees and players sitting down directly and talking about these issues, as I said, I think can only improve things.
Fourth row on the left and in the end.
Joseph Cachar on the score. Adam, you guys moved away from the East versus West format this year for the game itself, at least just for this year. But have you guys had any serious discussions about the prospects of potentially moving away from East-West, even in the selection process, and just going with the best 24 for the All-Star game?
It's interesting. I actually thought you were going to ask a different question, which is, it goes to whether we've had serious discussions about playoff format and whether we should actually be moving to the best 16 teams.
In
terms of the All-Star game itself, you know, it would require a lot of changes. Again, it really is related to how we schedule the games, because we don't play a balanced schedule. There's always been this notion that because it's unbalanced, the teams in the East are playing each other more than teams in the East are playing the West, that in the way even All-Stars are selected, you have the fan vote, then you have the coaches vote, that coaches in that conference, because they're seeing those players more often, should have more say in terms of who becomes an All-Star. So your logic is right. I mean, it could follow that we should be taking a look at the top 24 players in the league as opposed to doing East versus West. But it then takes me to where I thought you were going, which is when we get to the playoffs, should we be taking either the best 16 teams, or even if we go 8 from the West, 8 from the East, seeding 1 through 16 going into the playoffs. And that is something that has gotten serious attention, not just recently, but over the last few years at the league office. And I think, as I've said in the past, that the obstacle is travel. And it's not tradition, in my mind at least. It's that as we've added an extra week to the regular season, as we've tried to reduce the number of back-to-backs, that we are concerned about teams crisscrossing the country in the first round, for example. We are just concerned about the overall travel that we would have in the top 16 teams. Having said that, you'd like to have a format where your two best teams are ultimately going to meet in the finals. And obviously, if it's the top team in the East and the top team in the West, I'm not saying this is the case this year, but you could have a situation where the top two teams in the league are meeting in the conference finals or somewhere else. So we're going to continue to look at that. And it's still my hope that we're going to figure out ways. You know, maybe ultimately you have to add even more days to the season to spread out a little bit more to deal with the travel. Maybe air travel will get better. All things we'll keep looking at.
Sixth row on the left, Robert.
Robert Littell, Black Sports Online. Kevin Durant and LeBron James and others had very strong comments to the shut up and dribble comments from them that came from Fox News. What's the league responsibility, and how can they continue to get rid of the narrative that they're just dumb jocks, and specifically in LeBron's case, that he's an African-American athlete that isn't intelligent enough to talk about social issues and should just shut up and entertain people.
Well, let me begin by saying I'm incredibly proud of our players, you know, for using the platform they have as players in the NBA and on social media to speak out on issues that are important to them. And I was proud of LeBron and Kevin's response to the comments that were made, you know, about them. And, you know, I think even when I hear, even related to the one and done issue, when people say that the one and done players shouldn't be in college because they don't care about an education, I think it's incredibly unfair to them. Just because they have enormous opportunity in the way maybe Bill Gates did or Mark Zuckerberg to create enormous wealth for themselves and their family certainly doesn't mean that they don't care about an education. And many of them go on to continue to educate themselves, whether through going back to school in the summer, taking courses, doing things post-playing career. So it frustrates me. I should also say it's not lost on me or anybody in this room that there's enormous amount of racial tension in this country, enormous amount of social injustice, and I do see a role for this league in addressing those issues. And it's interesting, I know everybody can see, but Bill Russell happens to be sitting here at this press conference, and your question sort of reminds me of the role that players like Bill Russell have played historically in speaking out on important issues. And it's interesting, here we are in LA, and Bill, you probably remember this, but the first All-Star game that took place in Los Angeles was in 1963. You were the MVP, and then of course the Celtics went on to win a championship that year. But maybe even more importantly, then in the summer of 1963, you stood on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial when Dr. King gave his I Have a Dream speech. And so to me, there's this direct through line from players like Bill Russell, here there was, you know, roughly 55 years ago, to LeBron and Kevin Durant speaking out today on issues that are important to them. So as I've said before, to me, as commissioner of the NBA, this is a legacy of important work that I've inherited, that I continue to encourage. And it doesn't mean I necessarily agree with everything that's said at any given moment, but the fact that these players are not just basketball players, they're multidimensional, they care about their communities, and they care about what's happening in their country, and that they then care enough to speak out, at sometimes at great risk to themselves, because it's not lost on them that there are some people who will disagree with them, and social media is full of hate as well. So I just conclude by saying I'm really proud of them.